We shall commence this module by discussing about the Indian agriculture. Indian agriculture in India has been precariously dependent on the monsoons since time immemorial and has been an inherently activity plagued with uncertainty. Indigenous institutions of credit developed on account of seasonal fluctuations with a view to facilitate smoothing of the consumption pattern of farmers over the year. Frequent failures of the monsoons, rural indebtedness has been a chronic problem. On account of high interest charged due to high level of uncertainty inherent in traditional agriculture activity, Indian peasants suffer from perennial misery. The realization of the importance of rural credit in our context dawned as far back as the colonial era. India Central Banking Inquiry Committee was constituted to deal with this problem. While RBI was required to put special emphasis on agriculture credit, it was not until the inception of economic planning and the comprehensive analysis of this problem by the All India Rural Credit Survey Committee and its recommendation of an integrated scheme of rural credit that significant steps were taken to strengthen the institutional foundation of rural credit through developing the cooperative movement with state partnership. After studying this module, you shall be able to critical significance of credit for agriculture, different phases of evolution of agriculture credit in India, relevance and components of a new approach. Let us now understand the evolution of agricultural credit in India. Inadequacy of agricultural credit has had more than a century of tortuous history. Rakesh Mohan contributed to the literature by dividing the evolution of agricultural credit into a few phases to facilitate an easy comprehension. Different phases of evolution of agricultural credit are elaborated below. Phase 1. Intervention by RBI in rejuvenation of cooperative credit. During the period 1935-1950, the Reserve Bank was very actively involved in the attempt to recharge the cooperative credit movement through a number of initiatives. Apart from provision of financial accommodation to the cooperative movement, the RBI played a critical role in the building of the cooperative credit structure. Consequently, it slowly developed into its present structure with two separate arms, one for short-term credit and another for long-term credit. However, even a number of committees were appointed between 1945 and 1950. The efforts did not bring about proportionate results. As late as 1951, the provision of credit routed through cooperatives remained very little. Only 3.3% of the cultivators had access to credit from cooperatives, and the percent of beneficiary from commercial banks was even lower at 0.9%. The problem of agriculture credit was not mere a problem of coverage. There were issues including usurious interest rates and other practices inimical to borrowers. Legislation on money lending was advocated to check such malpractices. Phase 2. The foundation for building a broader credit infrastructure for agriculture. The basis for building a broader credit infrastructure for rural credit was laid by the report of the All India Rural Credit Survey 1954. The report pointed out that agriculture credit fell short of the right quantity and appropriate quality was often off the target. The committee also observed multiple flaws in performance of cooperatives in the sphere of agriculture credit. However, it simultaneously stressed that cooperatives had a crucial role in directing credit to the farmers. Phase third, period of significant change, 1960s to the 1980s. The Agriculture Refinance Corporation, ARC, was established by RBI in 1963 to provide funds by way of refinance, but credit cooperatives still did not function satisfactorily. The All India Rural Credit Review Committee was set up in July 1966. After a detailed analysis, the committee came out with the recommendation that commercial banks could play a complementary role along with cooperatives in extending rural credit. The need for social control and consequent nationalization of major commercial banks in 1969 and 1980 acted as a milestone in the efforts of leveraging the commercial bank system for providing agricultural credit. The idea of priority sector was introduced in 1969 with a view to finance certain neglected sectors including agriculture. Supply of credit to the priority sectors was ensured through a legal requirement that a certain proportion of the total net bank credit must be deployed in these sectors by specific target dates. It was also the case that the 1950s and 1960s had been characterized by a big industrial push with inadequate attention being given to agriculture. It was the 1965-67 drought that provided the flashpoint leading to concentrated attention to agriculture. The Green Revolution ushered in 1960s and 1970s called for adequate availability of credit for purchase of inputs through high yielding variety of seeds, pump sets for irrigation fertilizer and so on. Despite above mentioned steps, the flow of credit flow to the agriculture sector did not demonstrate any appreciable improvement. On the one hand, commercial banks were not tuned to the needs and requirements of small and marginal farmers, and cooperatives on the other hand lacked requisite resources to cope up with the anticipated demand. Establishment of a separate banking structure was recommended. It was argued that it must blend the local feel and familiarity of rural problems characteristic of cooperatives along with the professionalism and large resource base enjoyed by commercial banks. This led to setting up of regional rural banks, RRBs, following the recommendations of the Working Group on Rural Banks 1975, headed by N. Narasimham. Three separate institutions for providing rural credit emerged by the end of 1977. It is described as the multi-agency approach. The National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, NABARD, was set up in 1982 to provide credit for the promotion of, among other things, agriculture. It was in accordance with the recommendations of the committee after it reviewed the then arrangements for provision institutional credit for agriculture and rural development. The entire undertaking of the ARDC and the refinancing institutions of the RBI in relation to state cooperatives and RRBs was taken over by NABARD. Since it came into being, the NABARD has been playing a central role in providing financial assistance, facilitating institutional development, as well as supporting promotional efforts in the area of rural credit. The Rural Infrastructure Development Fund, RIDF, set up in 1995-96, is also administered by NABARD. The contribution of scheduled commercial banks to the corpus of RIDF makes up for their shortfall in agricultural lending under the priority sector targets. NABARD has been engaged in a catalytic role in microcredit through the conduit of self-help groups. Phase 4th, period of introspection and reforms. notwithstanding the impressive geographical spread, functional reach, and consequent decline in the influence of informal sources of credit, rural financial institutions intended to deliver rural credit emerged as inefficient, caused by erosion of repayment ethics impacting profitability. On the eve of the 1991 reforms, the rural credit delivery system was again found to be in a poor shape once again. A framework for undertaking all-encompassing financial sector reforms during the 1990s was provided by Narasimham Committee 1991. Furthermore, weaknesses in the performance of financial institutions since 1991 resulted in the setting up of various committees, working groups, and task forces to look into their operations. They made far-reaching recommendations relating to agricultural credit. A number of steps, including adoption of a Model Cooperative Act, state-level mutual assistance funds, and setting up of a Cooperative Rehabilitation and Development Fund at NABARD was suggested by Kapoor Task Force. Alongside, the Vyas Committee 2001 recommended various means to restore of the health of primary agriculture credit societies, PACS. They included the cooperative credit structure on a selective delayering, integration of short and long-term structures, and scrapping the cadre system. An advisory committee on flow of credit to agriculture and related activities from the banking system, Chairman S. Vyas, RBI 2004, also submitted its report. Majority of the recommendations of the committee have been actualized by RBI and NABARD. Subsequently, the Government of India had composed a task force to propose a plan for putting a new lease of life into the rural cooperative banking institutions. It was also assigned to assist an appropriate regulatory framework for these institutions. The government declared a host of measures in June 2004 to achieve a 100% rise the flow of agriculture credit over the period 2004-05 to 2006-07 by all financial institutions towards this end. It was proposed to increase agriculture credit by 30% to about rupees 1.05 lakh crore in 2004-05. The target set for 2004-05 was achieved. In the Union Budget 2005-06, it was announced that the government intends to continue with its efforts to nudge commercial banks, RRBs, and cooperative banks towards providing credit, particularly production credit, to rural households and firm households. In order to bring about innovation in agricultural lending, it was proposed to request the RBI to look into the issue of allowing banks to adopt the agency model by tapping the infrastructure of civil society organizations, rural kiosk, and village knowledge centers for lending to rural and farm sectors. It was also proposed to ask commercial banks, RRBs, and cooperative banks to increase the flow of credit by another 30% in 2005-06. These recommendations being implemented, it was also proposed to accept the report of the task force on revival of rural cooperative credit institutions in principle. Financial sector reforms constituted a core component of the overall structural reforms initiated in 1991 and included various measures in the area of agricultural credit. They included recapitalization of select RRBs, deregulation of interest rate of cooperatives and RRBs, selective deregulation of lending rates of commercial banks for loans, augmented refinance support from RBI and capital contribution to NABARD, constitution of the RIDF in NABARD for infrastructure projects, introduction of the Kisan Credit Card, KCC, and introduction of prudential accounting norms and provisioning requirement for all rural credit agencies. It was also stipulated that interest rate not exceeding 9% for crop loans up to Rs 50,000 be extended by the public sector banks. We shall now discuss the characteristics of the emergent scenario of agriculture finance. A striking feature of the agriculture credit scene has evolved in India relates to wide regional disparities in the disbursement of agriculture credit by scheduled commercial banks, excluding RRBs. The per capita coverage of agriculture credit in the eastern and northeastern region is extremely low. Since these data pertain to commercial banks, the puzzle before us is why such stark differences should exist between regions, given that Punjab, Haryana, and Western UP are the centers of the green revolution. One would have accepted a higher intensity of agriculture credit in the northern region. It is not clear why public sector banks, characterized by similar management, do and staff behave so differently between regions. If it is feasible for banks to do direct lending for agriculture in the southern states, one does not understand why it is not so in the other regions. Lastly, the magnitude of difference is also a cause for concern. All these issues need much greater research. It needs to be mentioned that in any program of viable agriculture credit extension, the central issue relates to the risk management. Risk management appears to be a crucial determinant of all the problems encountered in agricultural lending. It is found that the proportion of NPAs are indeed higher for agriculture than they are for the non-priority sector. However, they are not as high as those for small-scale industries. Let us now point out the following characteristics of the emergent scenario of agriculture finance. First, it took around 70 years of constant effort for institutional credit to reach a substantial proportion of farmers. Second, with the share of agriculture GDP falling in total GDP, it is to be expected that the share of agriculture credit will go down as a proportion of total credit. But we do need to ensure that it does not fall as a share of agricultural GDP and that it in fact intensifies. Third, there appears to be an urgent need for the adoption of the best modern techniques for risk management in agriculture. Fourth, banks need to adopt a more nuanced approach as between agriculture sectors and regions so as to achieve a better knowledge of agriculture credit needs and risk on a disaggregated basis. One needs to classify different sectors and regions on the basis of level of credit worthiness. One also needs to identify which agriculture activities and regions are getting more credit and why. Clearly, one shirt does not fit all. Fifth, there is an increasing need for alien activities and term lending. We may even need to rethink our traditional view of what constitutes agriculture. Next, we shall discuss the elements of a new approach. Putting an appropriate system of agriculture credit has to be an integral component of a strategy of development of agriculture in the country. Such a strategy has to factor in changing realities relating to the demand and supply aspects, apart from improvement in host of other aspects like storage, transportation, processing, agriculture marketing through build up requisite market infrastructure. The shift in the demand pattern for food asks for a reformulation of priorities in organizing and appropriate matching supply responses. Besides promoting diversification, there is also a need for value addition in agriculture production for increasing rural employment and incomes. Interestingly, very important changes are taking place in the agriculture sector in this regard. There are emerging tendencies of a much closer link among primary producers, trade intermediaries, food processing entities, and the eventual marketing of value-added products. The task of policy makers in designing an appropriate package of measures has emerged as more challenging, considering that the new growth areas of agriculture are characterized by a higher degree of heterogeneity, unlike in the case of wheat, rice, and milk. Production is often regionally concentrated, production and marketing conditions differ significantly, and the input requirements are equally heterogeneous. Hence, policies and programs for supporting higher productivity and production in these areas need to be much more region-specific, and knowledge such as storage, transportation, processing, and marketing of non-cereal products increases, which leads to greater links between agriculture diversification and rural industrialization. The success of this strategy would, however, depend crucially on developing adequate infrastructure and other support systems. It appears that the monopoly of government-regulated wholesale market has hampered emergence of a competitive marketing system in the country, rendering no help to farmers in direct marketing. An efficient agriculture marketing system provides outlets and incentives for increased production. It contributes greatly to the commercialization of subsistence farmers and hence should be regarded as a core component for development of the agriculture sector. The existing framework of State Agriculture Produce Marketing Committee Acts will have to undergo a change. If the agriculture markets are to be developed in private and cooperative sectors and are to be provided a competitive environment vis-a-vis regulated markets. In this context, the model Agriculture Produce Marketing Development and Regulation Act 2003 circulated in September 2003 acquires significance. If the banking system in India needs to reorient itself to meet the changing requirements of commercializing agriculture, it needs to design innovative schemes and products which recognize the differing nature of agribusiness and supply chains for different products. Apart from upgrading skills and changes in attitudes and mindset, one needs to put in place newer forms of credit assessment and risk management systems. Information technology needs to be harnessed to facilitate transformation in various processes of rural credit. Each bank should form a special task force to look into the entire gamut of credit in the context of the agriculture transformation. The best results could be obtained if these task forces are staffed with a mix of experienced bankers and enthusiastic young bankers with a penchant for innovation. Let us now summarize what we have discussed in this module. In the zeal to push through financial sector reforms and to turn the sector into a handmaiden of industry and trade, Naraina 1993, government and the pro-reform academics seem to be ignoring the crucial role banks have played in promoting private capital formation in agriculture. What is most disturbing is that while the need for quickening the pace of financial sector reforms is emphasized, not even a beginning has been made in working out alternatives in the sphere of agriculture credit. There is another side of the story, an aspect related to the political economy of lending. Kohle, 2008, observed that government-owned bank lending follows the electoral cycle. Agriculture credit increases by 5 to 10 percentage points in an election year. Large increases in agriculture lendings take place in districts in which the election is particularly close. Interestingly, this targeting does not exist in non-election years or in private bank lending. He demonstrated adverse impact of election on loan repayment on the one hand and insignificant impact of credit boom in election year on agriculture. The issue is to how may government-owned banks engaged in meaningful agriculture lending without being hijacked by narrow interest of industry, trade and political elite in power. A lot of efforts have been made since independence to address the problem of agricultural credit. A number of committees and task forces have been constituted which duly submitted their reports. No meaningful dent could be made on the problem despite repeated attempts by the state. Financial reforms bypassed agriculture credit. Policymakers need to factor in new realities. A complete reorientation of banks is a must. The political economy of rural credit needs to be understood.